Hannah Clarke was on the morning school run when she was ambushed by her estranged husband and murdered along with her three young children last year. It happened in a suburban Brisbane street, just a few hundred metres from Hannah's parents' home, where she'd taken the kids to escape her ex's escalating behaviour. Now, until that morning, he'd barely laid a hand on her, but there were many frightening red flags. Hannah's parents, Sue and Lloyd Clarke, have channeled their pain of losing their daughter and grandchildren into campaigning for coercive control to be criminalised. And they've just been named as Queensland's Australians of the Year for 2022 for their incredible work. And they join us now from Brisbane. Sue and Lloyd, thank you very much for being with us this morning.
Thank you for having us, Sarah.
Hi, Sarah. Thank you.
Now, Sue, this will be your second Christmas without Hannah and the kids. How are you both coping?
It's hard. Normally the kids would come over and help me put up the Christmas decorations. I suppose it doesn't mess with my OCD. I could do them my way now, not have the decorations all in the one side of the Christmas tree, but it's very hard without them.
Yeah, it mustn't really feel like Christmas anymore, Lloyd.
No, it doesn't. It's a lot quieter, very much so. Last year we just took Sue's dad out for lunch. So this year we'll do a similar thing, but we might, yeah, cook up a ham and a turkey and have him over and just, yeah, sit and reflect and be a quiet Christmas day.
Tell us about Hannah. She was such a devoted mum, wasn't she?
She always wanted to be a mum, right from when she was a little girl. She loved children and loved babies. And she adored her children. They were the most important thing to her. She was very bright and vibrant, Hannah. She had a smile that lit up the room. And she, a lot of her career, she spent teaching children, kindy gym and trampolining and things like this. She loved working with children. She wasn't perfect, but she was a good girl.
Yeah, she had that, like Sue said, that smile. It was always welcoming and you just felt very welcome when you saw her and she gave you that smile and you didn't know under the surface that there was things going on.
Yeah, we've also heard about Hannah's bravery in her final moments as she fought to stay alive and tell witnesses what had happened. And also her thoughts obviously had gone to her children who had also been murdered. An inquest into the murders of Hannah and her kids has been set down for next year. Do you feel that the system let your daughter down?
The only way the system let her down was coercive control. It was not legislated, it wasn't law then to be coercive controlling. And, you know, we look back now and there's so many things we possibly could have done if we would have known. We knew it wasn't right, but, yeah, we could have sort of helped.
What is coercive control?
Yeah, I feel she was well looked after. Sorry?
Sorry to interrupt you. You said you thought that she was well looked after by Queensland Police, but this whole idea of coercive control becoming a crime in Australia, it's still got a long way to go. Can you explain what it is?
Yeah, it's repeat behaviour. Well, actually, bad behaviour. And it starts slowly. Like in Hannah's case, we didn't think anything was different. It seemed to quite a normal relationship. But 3 years down the track, it became more controlling, more belittling. He would get angry and take it out on her in front of people at the gym, controlling where she went, what she did, going through her phone, her handbag, controlling what she wore. And it's just a beat down over a period of time of, you know, humiliation, and it's sort of, yeah, broke her soul, basically.
And coercive control, it's quite an insidious form of abuse, isn't it? It doesn't leave physical bruises, so it can be hard to identify. And then there's also that sleight of hand. For example, you'd both said that Hannah wasn't allowed to wear shorts around her husband, and you sort of just put that down to the fact that maybe he might have been a bit of a prude.
Exactly right. And one of the signs we know now in hindsight, when they first got together, he got her to close down her Facebook page, saying that they would have a joint Facebook page because they had the same friends and they would be doing the same posts. And again, that was something that could be explained away, as it made sense. So there's a lot of little things in hindsight we can see now that were explained away, and it just gradually gets worse and worse, even down to he would question the children. Where did you go today? Who did Mummy talk to today? To find out things that way as well.
Yeah, it's that... I said it starts off gradual and then it comes through. And at the end of the day, when we spoke to experts on domestic violence, these are the ones that don't do physical harm. They're the more dangerous ones because when they start spiralling and escalating out of control and they're not on the upper scale of the spectrum where they're controlling that person, they then do something, wild and crazy like he did. Mm.
There are laws against coercive control in some parts of the world, including the UK. You're both campaigning to have it criminalised here, but what are some of the challenges involved with making this kind of behaviour illegal? Because it is hard to identify.
It's very hard to identify. That's why we need education first before we can actually make it a law. Mm. We need to educate the police, we need to educate judges, first responders, welfare workers, everyone to understand what the signs are.
And I think you'll find that what Scotland did, they sat back, they've got the gold class standard for coercive control laws. They looked at what England and Wales and Ireland had done and then took the best out of that. It actually took them 4 years to get their laws right and up and running. So Queensland's going to do okay. Hopefully next year the legislation will be written up. They'll start changing the DV laws first. And in the meantime, the education will start. Community also will need to be educated on what the red flags are. So Scotland have basically a checklist that you can run off and tick that checklist. And the more ticks you get, well, the more coercive control situation it is.
If another young woman or another woman out there or perhaps their families is watching this and thinking perhaps they might be in a violent relationship, perhaps one that is plagued by coercive control, what would you like to say to them? What should they do if they see the red flags?
It's very hard. If you see the red flags with someone you know, I would plant the seed that this isn't okay, that this isn't a good relationship, but you can't force a woman to leave. No. They need to leave in their own time. It's not easy to go. It could be they have no money, nowhere to go, and also they have no self-esteem. They've been beaten down so long and told that they won't survive without him. Mm. So it's very hard for them to leave. But if you can plant the seed and let them know that you believe them, let them know they're validated in what they're saying, and let them know you're there to support them as soon as they're ready to go. Mm. And also, if you see a friend of yours who's actually perpetrating these qualities, you could speak to them and say, hey, mate, that's not cool. That's not how you speak to somebody, or that's not how you treat them. Is everything okay? Can I help?
Yeah.
And also, Beyond DV, we've done some work with them and they've actually brought out an app that you can get on. It's called Love and Learn. Great for teenagers because there's 20 questions there that they can go through and ask about the relationship that you're in. And then it gives you a percentage at the end of that 20 questions. And, if you're anything, from 50% down, I think you need to look at that relationship. And it just gives you an insight on what a healthy relationship should look like.
And as you said, it's very complicated leaving in a relationship like this. In fact, I think it took Hannah at least 4 times before she was able to flee to your house to safety. Before we let you go, Brisbane Council has constructed a lovely memorial that they've called Hannah's Place. Can you tell us about it? It's a special park that was close to Hannah's heart.
It was. It's just down the road from our house and it's across the road from the high school where she was school captain and spent her whole school life. She used to play touch football on the fields there and I used to take the children to the parkland there to play on the swings. So it's very close to our heart.
Yeah, it's a shelter, and they've done it very tastefully. There's four trees that will grow and produce lovely pink flowers at the end of the day. So hopefully that'll bring the butterflies in, which is part of our symbol. And it's just a place where people can go and reflect, have a think, and, yeah, think about Hannah and the kids, or just spend some time there.
Sue and Lloyd Clarke, you're both remarkable people. Thank you so much for talking with us today and for your incredible work as well in helping criminalise coercive control here in Australia. If you'd like more information, you can also head to smallstepsforhannah.com.au. Sue and Lloyd Clarke, thank you again for your time.
Thank you so much for having us, Sarah.